Except for see the actual play. I'm so excited. I wish you guys like put on the play again or something like that, where I can see the play. I read the play and read everything about it. I don't know if people use social media or go online and just see all this kind of controversy started by these two critics. So I'm very happy that you guys are here to talk about this play and then all the things that's gonna happen after these two critics with these two reviews. So you want to just introduce yourselves and just start talking about this really, really, really interesting play.
Sure. My name is Hallie Gordon. I'm the Artistic and Education Director for Steppenwolf Young Adult at Steppenwolf Theatre Company. I'm a producer, a director, and programmer for young adult theatre. My age group that I work for is 8th through 12th grade. Mm-hmm.
Great. Hi, I'm Lisa Cortez. I'm also from Chicago. I am a director. I'm also the head of MFA directing at the theater school at DePaul University, and I'm the artistic director for Chicago Playwrights. Many of you will be at the theater school at DePaul University in a couple of days, I think. Driving up the 65 for the QIA USA conference, run by my dear colleague, Ernie Nolan. And I was the director of This Is Modern Art at Steppenwolf. Hallie was crazy enough to hire me.
So actually, I want to start with excerpt from the review that was in the Sun Times. Just like when you open up the paper and reading about a play, you know, a lot of people will read reviews of plays they've never seen. So this is what she said about This Modern Art, and then we can learn about what the play actually is about and what the message actually is. So, I don't know how long she's been at the Sun Times, but she said this play is wildly wrong-headed and potentially damaging work, one that fails to call vandalism by its name and rationalizes an attempt to justify the vandalism in the most irresponsible ways. It also trades in all the destructive, sanctimonious talk about minority teens invariably being shut out of opportunities and earmarked for prison. In a way that only reinforces stereotypes and negative destinies. Counterproductive in the extreme, it deepens and solidifies racial and class divisions, and a sense of hopelessness among those who need to dwell on possibility. And Hengwa, she's older, she's white. Chris Jones from the Chicago Tribune writes, graffiti comes at a price. It can be invasive, self-important, and disrespectful of the property of others. And plenty of struggling folks have had to clean graffiti off something they own or love. Graffiti can be inartful, for goodness sake. More importantly yet, graffiti had the effect of making people feel unsafe in the city. It terrified people. It was only when public officials declared themselves determined to wipe it out that cities finally came back to life with broad benefits. There's no real time. Let's see.
Oh, no,
so there's no action of graffiti in Lisa Porta's production, which really bugged me, actually. Although I did admire the acting and the way Portis connects these artists to the audience. At one point, the characters all provide a lesson in how to create graffiti. All that was missing was handing out spray cans to the audience.
Yeah, I was curious about that part about how he was bummed out that there was no... I should first of all say Chris Jones is a friend. Any of us who work in Chicago theater, we're a community. And, you know, we both know Chris and we both know Petty. And they both have been in the papers for a long time. And, you know, Chicago has a real history with the critical community started by Richard Christensen, where the critics are really part of the community. It's not like in other cities that I've lived in that will go unnamed. So the first thing to say is that these are folks that we know. But I was curious about Chris's idea of there being graffiti on stage, because one, it's like, it's toxic, you know what I mean, like the fumes. And then two, you know, that they were actors. I mean, they were not graffiti on
stage.
And
graffiti art is...
Hard.
It's hard.
It's an art skill.
It's a skill and it's an art form.
So this is modern art. It's about four young graffiti artists in Chicago who set out to tag the side of the new modern wing of the Art Institute, and it's based off of events in 2010.
Right. So for those of you who don't know, This Is Modern Art is based on two events. These were taken from interviews from many graffiti artists around the city. Based on this graffiti crew that graffiti bombed outside of the Art Institute of Chicago, the new modern wing, which was a $300 million building. And just as it opened, they graffitied their names over the student entrance and put "This Is Modern Art." So it was a political act that they were, the reason they were doing it. It wasn't random graffiti. As these reviews would lead you to believe. It was a very specific act of saying, we are not invisible, we live in this city, and we want to be heard. And that's what the play was about.
Yeah, the play was about, you know, how they came to that moment, how the graffiti crew came to that moment, and then the fallout from that moment, because both reviews will say that there was no fallout. A group of friends, four friends, who started the groups, you know, worked together, created together, ate together, lived together, and then after this event went underground and dispersed. Though none of them went to jail, they're still underground. The statute of limitations has not run out. I'll be interested to see what happens when 2017 comes around and they can come out. What will happen? Mm-hmm. I'm waiting for them.
How did Steppenwolf come in contact with the writers? Were there still women there? How did you guys decide to commission this play?
Sure, well, Kevin Koval is the artistic director of Young Chicago Authors and founder of Louder Than Bomb. And so he is well-versed in youth programming and hip-hop culture. And Idris Goodwin, who's a playwright, has worked under Kevin. And they came to me with this idea. And I thought it was a beautiful story and really interesting. And I came from a place of not understanding really what graffiti art is and being very curious. And generally that's how I program things. Things that I don't understand is what I like programming. And so I wanted to learn more about this world that I didn't know about. So they came to me, we commissioned them. We did a workshop. We got into the New Voices, New Visions at the Kennedy Center. We did a workshop there and a reading. Some of you I know heard that reading. And then we did another workshop at Steppenwolf, and then the show went up. Mm-hmm.
Did you have any idea there would be pushback, graffiti being
something? We weren't kidding ourselves. I mean, I think we knew there were specific, like the moment that is referred to about the showing young people how to graffiti, the tools that are needed. We knew there would be a lively conversation about it. We did not know that we would be railed against because of our inability to have a moral compass in the show. And I think my surprise came out of the fact that the critics really felt like they had the right to say what was appropriate for children, for teenagers, and what wasn't. And to me, that's not reviewing the play. That comes from a very personal place. And I will say, too, that the critics who come and see these shows do not come to a student performance. I think Hetty may have, Chris did not. They come to public performances with the general public. They do not go to our teacher residencies. They do not go into the classroom. They do not stay for the post-show. They do not read our study guide. They don't go through our teaching artist training programs. They don't know any of the work that goes into what it takes to put a show up for young people. So what I found controversial was not whether they liked the play or didn't, but that they were saying, I mean, Hetty's title was, "What Was Steppenwolf Thinking?" And to me, that's a judgment that goes far and beyond what any critic should be critiquing.
Well, I think what's interesting, and the reason this turned into a firestorm is because I mouthed off on Facebook. I'm currently, there's a lot of conversations going on around the country about diversity and inclusion. TCG, the Diversity and Inclusion Institute, LORT, Actors Equity, USITT, Broadway League. There are conversations happening all over the country, and of course in TYA USA, about diversity and inclusion, and somebody who's been a part of those conversations I just couldn't be quiet because I felt that this was not, had either Chris or Hetty not liked the show, you know, the direction is terrible, okay, I mean, that's fine, you know what I mean, or the acting is, you know, whatever, we don't like to play. But the fact that it felt to me censorial, it felt to me like this content should not be put in front of young adults. Hallie Gordon doesn't know what she's doing. Steppenwolf is being irresponsible. And that's when I said, from what lens are Hetty and Chris looking at this? And they're looking at it from a very particular lens. It's a white upper middle class, slightly older. They're not much older than I am, by the way.
Which they let us know.
Yeah. when Chris says people are terrified of graffiti, it begs the question, which people? Which people? Or when Chris says, our way in is through Selena, who is a white, the white woman in the play, right? The other characters are all of color. So when you hear, our way in is Selena, who is our? And it was that I really kind of mouthed off about, was this idea of who's deciding what's appropriate for young urban teenagers in the city of Chicago, one of the most complex, multicultural cities in the nation, and also a deeply segregated city. I mean, what Hallie did when she programmed this piece is she kind of turned Steppenwolf inside out. You know, the insiders were no longer your average theater-going audience, and no longer the critics were used. The insiders were not the insiders. The insiders were the outsiders, and the insiders were now the teenagers who were coming to see the play. To some extent, Hallie graffitied all over Steppenwolf. You know, Steppenwolf graffitied on itself. And it was just interesting that afterwards, it's like the play, what happened afterwards was like the play happened. Mm-hmm. You know, that Hallie graffitied on Steppenwolf, and Steppenwolf supported her in that, and then the critics went crazy. And then the city went crazy. You can't do that. You can't write that at Steppenwolf. You can't do that. So it's interesting the way in which kind of life imitates art.
So, being in the business for a while, like, you know, you have interaction with critics, and sometimes you get mixed reviews, positive reviews, negative reviews. This is the first time you've kind of mounted counterattack.
Because again, I know it's a critic's job to let us know what they think of the work itself, you know, of the artistry. But it's definitely the first time, because it was a political fight. You know, so yeah, it's the first time I've mouthed off.
What, so?
No, it's the first time you've mouthed off about that. It's the first time I've mouthed off about critics and Facebook. And I was actually, Howie was prepared for it. I wasn't prepared for the reviews at all, and I wasn't prepared for the level of...
I have to say that the first review you read from the Sun-Times, I was laughing because it's hard to take that seriously. I mean, it really, to me, it feels so over the top I don't know. There's something unreal about that. If you had written a play about this, no one would believe it. it comes from so much fear, that it's not even a review, you know. I mean, it's a therapy session. It's not, you know, so it's hard to take that the Sun-Times review series.
And yet you still have to say something, because when you have black and brown bodies on stage, young black and brown men on stage, and the reviewer calls them urban terrorists, you have to say something.
Which the Sun-Times did. The Sun-Times called it. And the Sun-Times also, you know, and I will say the Sun-Times because I believe that they should be responsible for what's being printed, but the Sun-Times likened it to gun violence. And, you know, to me, again, this says something, you know, in terms of where we're at, that graffiti art can induce that kind of fear, that the next step, if you see graffiti art, that means someone's going to get shot. That there's something, and obviously we know this, just look at the world, just look at America right now, that we're living in, and that a piece of theater is supposed to speak to this, right? We are supposed to present work to young people that allows them an opportunity to think for themselves, to question, to wonder, to be passionate, to be curious. And this play did all of those things. And I think that there's fear in that. There's fear in opening the door to curiosity. When adults feel that underlying it is the wrong message.
So. Chris Jones, the writer for the Chicago Tribune, was pretty responsive. Like, he was on Facebook, and I don't know if you know, like, Facebook friends or, you know, you guys were connected.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. And so, you know, he said, you know, the review wasn't about race, that he's championed a lot of, African-American playwrights, a lot of African-American, people of color on the stage. So it wasn't, you know, he didn't feel fair that, you guys be defensive or pulling that card.
Yeah, I mean, Chris is a Facebook friend, and he is a friend. We teach together at DePaul University, and we were recently all three on a panel together. And I, you know, again, the way critics work in the community, critics are a part of community. Chris has indeed championed a lot of really fantastic work. I just think he got this one wrong. You know, I just think that his point of view on this one was a little tinned and slightly blunt. But I think that he's, I respected his opinion and I respected everything that he's done in Chicago. I just think it was on the wrong side of history on this one. But I will say that I mean this authentically, I don't mean this sarcastically, I'm incredibly thankful for the reviews from the Trib and the Sun-Times. And I will say, you know, Time Out, Reader, New City, all of those reviews, the fact, one, that they're coming to review TYO Theater is important and huge and allows the work to grow. And also, because they were so personally affected by it, it allowed for this conversation. It allowed for the community to really think about how we critique theater, how we critique new work, and how we critique something that makes us feel uncomfortable.
And what is that conversation? And how do we have it with each other? How do we be in the same room and have it? How do we be in the virtual room and have it? But that the fact that this conversation is happening and that Lisa and I are here today still talking about it, I think is really important.
And also I want to say, I really have great respect and admiration for Chris, precisely because he did stay in the debate. He did get on Facebook and stay in the debate. I mean, he'll tell you, as he said in the panel, he said he just happened to be in a room alone in New York drinking, and he was like, so he had to get, you know what I mean? We all know that moment. But he spoke that out loud in the panel we were on. But I did respect him because he's continued to show up. You know, we were all asked to be on a panel together at DePaul, and he did show up. And Chris has remained in the conversation, and I respect that and admire it. Because that's when you actually have a healthy debate, you know, as opposed to people, you know, hot shots.
So when we were talking about race, like people talk about, you know, it's like the question of authorship, like do you judge the thing itself, or do you look at the color of the person who wrote it? You know, if you look at a play, you know, about an African-American family, like sometimes there's a question of, well, was it a white writer, was it a black writer, and can I judge it based on the color of the writer? So can you apply that to your critics? Like if there were two black critics who had written the same thing, like how much does it matter the color of skin of the people who wrote this negative review?
I don't think a person of color would have written what the Sun Times published. I just don't think it's possible. Not with that tone. There's a lot of hatred in there and fear. You know, I think anybody, any color should be able to be a critic. I mean, but I think that, again, I think it's because it comes from a personal perspective, from this moral compass of this is not right, in which these stories are important to be told. These people, are exciting and real and authentic to the city, and their voices are important. Again, it's okay if you don't like the play, if you didn't think it was, you know, even enough, if you didn't like, for whatever reason, that's fine. But this story is valuable to the community.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with Hallie. I don't think that a person of color would have written a Sun Times review. And if somebody had written similar reviews, whatever their color of skin, I probably still would have mapped them.
So as a arts critic and reporter, like I get really nervous when I write reviews sometimes because I'm like friends with a lot of local playwrights. And it, you know, if I wrote something bad on the IRT or something like that, I don't know, I talk to Courtney and Jamie and, you know, all the people all the time. So I'd be really nervous. And so for me, it's like, it's my craft and I kind of unleash it. And then hopefully people like my review. And then people hate it. It's like, oh my God, you know, why is all this backlash against my review? So that's kind of like the way I see it, where it's like, there's just two writers, they're just trying to do their job. And then a bunch of people kind of swirl around and they get a race card. So sometimes I sympathize with just a writer trying to navigate, you know, being truthful to their opinion and not just being nice and trying to please everyone all the time.
Yeah, I mean, I hear what you're saying. I mean, I would say this to Chris in person, and I'd say to him in print. I think that a writer in a city like Chicago has a responsibility to think about the totality of the city that he or she is speaking for. That doesn't mean that the point of view has to be. So I'm talking about content. I'm not talking about aesthetics. Mm-hmm. Aesthetics, again, how about it? And I'm talking about whether or not something is valid to be on stage, whether or not this topic is valid on stage for this audience. I think that, you know, as theater artists, we are used to people going against it. You know what I mean? So I think sometimes if the community responds to a critic and says, hey, guess what? We think you're wrong, you know, and I kind of go, well, so you can take some too. You know, I don't know. Mm-hmm.
I think it's challenging for artists because this is in print, you know, and this is, and it's important. It's important for our audiences, it's important for ticket sales, it's important to the artists involved. It's important whether a new play gets done again. It's important whether a theater decides to do a new work or not do a new work. So I think all those things are important. And so I think what was fascinating is that, you know, the theater community lashed back and said, this is too important just for it to stay in these two reviews. And that's where the conversation came out of. And I think that, you know, I think we're very lucky at how close the theater community is in Chicago, but I think they basically said enough is enough. And I think we're allowed to, just like the critics are allowed to say what they say. And, you know, Patty and Chris have had every right to write what they wrote. We have every right to talk about how that makes us feel and how that makes the community of people they're talking about feel. And it's important for that community to talk about it as well.
You know, I think it's so interesting, like, this is a play about the relationship between artists and the people who act as gatekeepers and people who decide who becomes artists and not. And I think traditionally journalists and arts journalists have thought of themselves as gatekeepers in certain ways. Like, we validate, you know, we kind of curate, you know, the art scene. And there's this really interesting, talking about history, the idea of an artist making its mark on history. And, you know, graffiti, as you know, if it's marked in a legal spot, it gets reported. The property owner needs to pay a fine if they don't do anything about it. So it'll be buffed in like 1, 2, 3 days. Mm-hmm. So the relationship between kind of this kind of visual art and history. So there's a scene where JC, mm-hmm. One of the graffiti artists. So the three graffiti artists and the fourth character is the
lookout.
Yeah, the lookout. And so JC, he wants to make his mark in history. So he says, legends stand on their work. When you discipline yourself to become a great artist, legendary status will be left to those who write history. And then Seven, the other main character, says, well, what if people who write history are some narrow-minded busters who stay getting late passes on what's fresh? JC says, the hope is to be great enough, to be disciplined enough, and put in so much work that my legacy will be undeniable and history will write itself. Seven says, I feel you, Jace, and you, my man and all, but I'm saying, fuck those who write history. I'm saying, I want to do something that will have an impact now, not years from now, you know, because now is where we live, and now is all messed up, and now is the only time we got, and you know that better than anyone. So he says, history. So that could be a comment towards museums, but also arts critics as well. Can you talk about a little bit more about the content of the play?
What do you mean?
Just in terms of like this idea of the people who write the history, who say, this is what happens, you know, Chicago's theater scene.
I mean, I can say that within the play there is, and speak to this too, within the play there is a debate about where and how art happens, mm-hmm. and who legitimizes art. And I think the graffiti writers, there are graffiti writers that do permission walls, there are graffiti writers that do mural, there are graffiti writers who go down to Miami during Art Basel and create work that stays there. There are other graffiti writers, and some of those graffiti writers will say it's not really graffiti unless it's illegal. Some graffiti describe it as, it's not graffiti unless it's illegal practice, otherwise it's public art. So there's a big conversation about the relationship between graffiti art and permanence, and what constitutes a piece of art. If it's impermanent, is it a piece of art? I think those of us in theater would argue, yes. if it's illegal, is it a piece of art? So I think there's a lot of conversations about the relationship between permanence, art, and legitimacy in the piece. In terms of
I think too, in this particular scene, he was also talking about the fact that he wants to make history when he's alive, not when he's dead. But that he wants people to see and hear him now. And there's, again, that goes back to the sense of not being heard and not feeling like you're going to be part of these graffiti artists in real life and in the play know the canon of art, history art, and they know it very well. But nobody knows their canon. You know, nobody knows their art. Nobody knows the famous graffiti artist that started in the late 70s and 80s in, you know, in the boroughs of New York, you know. And they tell us who they are, you know. And so they're, you know, they feel marginalized on many levels, you know, on what they look like and what they do. And I think that's what, you know, that's what he, Seven, is frustrated.
You know, it's so interesting because that question that you raised earlier, like when you said, as a critic, it makes me stressed out when people, you know, if I write my thing and everybody, there's a backlash. Mm-hmm. It's interesting because to some extent, and I think you're trying to get at this, right? The thing to do with a museum is to pay, you pay a fee and you go inside and you see the art. Mm-hmm. And the thing to do with a review is you read the review and you take it or leave it, you know? But the thing to do with a museum is not to write on the outside of it. And the thing to do with a review is not to spout off on Facebook about it. I mean, it's just interesting because the whole kind of interaction is really about who gets to say what when
and where.
You know, so from that is the core of the play itself, and it is the core of the controversy that happened after the play, which is the theater critic said this, and usually that would be the end of it, right? Because that, you know. We don't generally respond, nor should we necessarily. You know what I mean? But in this case, a bunch of us did respond, and so that, to some extent, is like scribbling on the outside of the museum. It's going against the norm in order to ultimately bring up create a counter narrative. Finally, a counter narrative. Graffiti is a counter narrative to the narrative of the city of Chicago. The argument on Facebook was a counter narrative to the unified critical point of view about whether or not this was appropriate on stage.
How has the way you've looked at theater criticism changed in the past like 10 years, you know, Facebook and Twitter, and you know, like other bloggers that you interface with now? Like are the critics still as powerful and as many as they used to be before? How that's changed?
I don't know. I mean, I think I try not to overly pay attention to, I really do. I mean, this is a very special case, but I think that as an artist, not as a producer or programmer, but as an artist, I think it's better to leave that aside. You know, I think as a producer and a programmer, it's challenging, and I feel like the Chicago Public School District, I feel very fortunate in that they trust the work that Steppenwolf for Young Adults does. They don't; those teachers don't necessarily read reviews and then book their tickets. But we were almost sold out before we even started marketing This Is Modern Art. We were in a 500-seat theater, which we normally, for a new play, don't open the balcony. We had to open the balcony for This Is Modern Art because it was the first play. It was a play that was actually talking about visual art. And so we had art schools coming and art classes coming. And everyone got a script ahead of time. Everyone knew the language of it. Everyone knew the age appropriateness of it. Everyone got stuck. You know, there was all of that involved in it. And so, you know, the fact that it got a bad review or controversial review usually does not matter. The interesting thing about this is that schools who came and brought their students then read the review because they heard about the controversy, spent classroom time discussing it. and analyzing it, and really having a really interesting, robust conversation about what their students saw and what the critics saw. We got many letters from students and teachers around this, and I had high schools and universities from all over the country calling, asking for the script because they were reading the reviews and they wanted to teach it in their class, and they wanted to have an open conversation about art criticism. And so, I mean, that's just awesome.
And it's great because, to Paul alone, I taught it in one of my classes, the reviews, people had seen the play. Chris taught it in his class. Koya Pass, who runs Free Street, taught it in her class, you know what I mean? Like, so that's it, DePaul alone. It was weird. I guess what's different now is, I think critics still have power. I absolutely do, otherwise I may not have said anything. I think, you know, I was fighting for the audiences that weren't being seen by the critics. And I was also fighting for the fact that I want other places to do this kind of work. I don't want other theaters to get scared of programming new work that makes people uncomfortable, do you know what I mean? Because it's essentially, I would hate to see a smaller theater that isn't as well insulated as Steppenwolf, decide not to do a play that is This Is Modern Art or like This Is Modern Art because of fear that the critics might shut it down. But what I would say to the critics, what is different now is that Facebook provides a platform by which if you want, if you have something to say, you can. Whereas writing a letter to the editor may never make the paper.
I will also say that I think, you know, the reason this show was targeted, I'm sure the review would have been somewhat different if this was for an adult audience. Mm-hmm. I think the reason it was targeted was because Steppenwolf for Young Adults presents itself as an educational program. And with that comes a certain amount of responsibility, as you all know, whenever you're doing work for young people. There's a certain amount of responsibility involved. And so the lens in which this play was being reviewed was through that lens. The unfortunate part was they never saw the work involved, like I mentioned earlier. So I do think that this is specific because we are saying this is a show for young people. It's about these artists that do something illegal and get away with it. Though there are repercussions for that. One, there's, you know, one loses his life, basically. One loses all his friends, doesn't have a job, can't paint anymore. And one actually learns self-confidence and understands and is excited by the fact that he is now being asked to do permission walls, meaning he's getting paid. And he likes being able to sign his name for real, as opposed to a false identity. So I think, you know, again, none of our kids walked away saying, where's a spray paint can? I want to go spray paint something. But all of the kids that we work with walked away with this idea of their voice and how important it is to follow your passion and what that means and what does it mean to be in a world in which there are certain areas, certain people, certain places that you can't do that. And what does it mean to fight for it, to be able to do that? And so that's what they came away with. And not to mention the fact that they now go on the train, they now drive in their car with their parents, and they see the city in a totally different way. And this happened for adults too, who said, I was on the train and I saw this graffiti and I saw the initials. I knew who you were talking about. I knew what it was and I wondered how did they get up there. So they started viewing their city that they had grown up in, that they had lived in totally differently. And to me, that's such an amazing, beautiful thing.
Yeah, to me what the play did is it made the city legible. You know, it really did. The city that you're not used to, you're like, oh, what's that? And then suddenly my kids are like, oh mom, that's NUL crew or that's so-and-so crew. Oh gosh, my cousin the other day was like, mom, that piece got buffed. 3 weeks and they buffed it. Why'd they do that? But you know, it allows you to read, because the cities are encoded. You know, cities are encoded. And there is a narrative that's put forth by the powers that be in a city, and then there's a whole other narrative or a number of narratives. projects going on. So it just made the city, I think, legible to many people. And there's one other thing I wanted to say. The argument just reminded me a little bit of, you know, when Elvis first moved his pelvis on. Don't do that, don't show the kids that Elvis movement. You know, I was like, don't show the kids that graffiti. Don't show them that. And then, you know, I also protest that. I think that young teenagers have minds of their own. And I think that the incredible care that Stefan will put into everything surrounding the production, the study guides, the talkbacks, the education in the schools, the workshops. I mean, no kid that saw the show was like, oh yeah, go do something illegal now.
And every kid knew it was illegal.
What's going to happen to the play? Do you have any idea?
I don't. I mean, we had a couple of people ask for it. We'd send it out. I don't know. You know, again, this is an interesting conversation. It falls into that weird area. You know, we commission and produce plays that is for a specific age group, which I mentioned, 8th through 12th grade. So it's too old, right? There's 7th and younger. Mm-hmm. But the theater, you know, community as a whole use it as TYA, so it may not go on the main stage of a regional theater. So it's in a weird place where a lot of our show, I mean, there's only a few of our shows that have actually, like The Bluest Eye and a couple other plays that we've commissioned and produced that have gone on to, you know, a more general audience rather than just a specific age group. We'll see.
So can you talk more about like how this play and themes of, huh?
I was gonna ask a question.
Oh, yeah.
And
should we open it up to
because just on that second production that I would love to hear you guys speak about what strategies or what offerings would you not only in production but in outreach for the you know, knowing what you know now, and in the second life of this, produced somewhere else, what were the things that you would share with those producers, you know?
You gotta be brave. I mean, I think, you know, we thematize our season each year. This thing is create a movement, the art of a revolution. So obviously we did that. We opened with Animal Farm, a new adaptation of Animal Farm, and you know, here's animals killing animals, and nobody really cared about that. So we really programmed this season in conversation about what does it mean to have a revolution, which was Animal Farm, and why do we have revolutions, what are the importance of that, and what is the cautionary tale that comes out of that, right? And then this is modern art, was how do we create that movement? What does that look like and feel like? What do you need to have a voice in something? And I think that, you know, in terms of guiding and framing it for your audience and for your teachers and students, we found that very helpful.
I think that it might be interesting to figure out how, I mean, I'm thinking of the critical community right now, and I don't know anything, I'm not a producer. Well, I am, but not for theater. That Chicago Playwrights isn't dependent on reviews. I would be interested in, if I were producing someplace else, seeing if I can get features about graffiti or graffiti artists in that city, trying to create a conversation in advance in the newspapers and in the media about graffiti and graffiti art, so there's a context bubbling ahead of time, you know what I mean, that into which the piece might come. I don't know, though. I think as a director, I would just say the charisma and presence of the actors who are talking to that audience are really, really important. Mm-hmm. It's important that the people who are in the audience see themselves on stage.
Any other questions?
There's one right.
You've spoken about the theater community response and the education community response. I was curious about what was the museum's response, and what was the visual arts community response to both the piece and the controversy?
The Art Institute, right from the get-go, we were in conversation with them, we gave them the script, we told them we were
doing this. We actually had an open reading at the Museum of Contemporary Art, in which we invited museums, other museums to. We were in communication with our community programs coordinator and their educational coordinator. We were ready to do a big panel with Kevin Koval and Miguel, who is a graffiti artist and also teaches at the Art Institute. And the script kept going, moving up higher and higher within the theater internally. And the Art Institute, as are many arts organizations, a very big bureaucracy. Well, it got as high as it could go, and they said no. No, they said no to the panel, and they said no to a partnership. We totally, you know, go ahead and produce the play, go ahead and do that. We respect that. There's still many hurt feelings at the institution to have this conversation, which I found really interesting because, of course, the crew who worked in, and I shouldn't say crew because that means something else in this context, but the staff that worked in the educational community programs area said, this is exactly the conversation we need to be having. Where does art belong? You know, what does it mean if graffiti is inside? Does it make it graffiti? Like, we're having these conversations behind doors. Now's an opportunity to open it up. But they just weren't ready. I will say, though, that they did bring a group of students who work at the art, you know, they have their own kind of young council there to see the show, and they asked questions during the post-show, and so it was a good conversation, and I felt good on both sides of how we kind of cooperated. We cooperated not to cooperate with each other. So that was the Institute, and then what was the other part of that?
The larger art community.
Oh, yeah, that is. Yes. We got pushback from MUL, Mejuba. So this
that's
is really,
crew.
That's the graffiti crew that bombed outside of the Modern Wing. Apparently the graffiti artists that these were based on, who did that, were not officially MUL crew members yet.
Kevin says that's not.
Well, this is, but okay. So apparently this is what the elder, this is all vocabulary I just learned throughout this process. The elder of the crew said they were on probation. Whether it's true or not, I don't know, that's what they said. They hired a lawyer. They went to Kevin, the writer, and said, you know, you're appropriating our name and our artwork, our likeness, blah, blah, blah. So we had a really great conversation. We invited him to come see a rehearsal. We were in really great conversation throughout the process, and everything ended up working fine. He loved the show. He brought other graffiti writers to see it. We ended up having the major national graffiti artist there on stage. Almost every graffiti artist that was actually mentioned in the play happened to be there one night. We got them all up on stage.
Kickstarting salsa.
For a post-show conversation that was just incredibly, incredibly moving. And so that was an interesting controversy that ended up not being anything, but was really, you know, these artists are artists, and their work matters to them. And that, you know, again, that was just another moment for us to be like, that's right, they're artists. Like, everyone who's a part of that art making needs to be a part of this experience. We had artists, you know, coming to see the show that have never walked in the door of Steppenwolf Theater. I mean, I have to say that I would say about 50% of our audience have never walked through the door of Steppenwolf. The most class, race diverse audience, age diverse that I've ever seen. Over here, and then over here, yeah.
First of all, the story of the controversy about this play would make a great play.
Yeah.
I'd like to hear from everybody on the panel about the idea of, Tally, you said a number of times, the critics who really blasted you were not aware of nor did they participate in any of the preparatory work that you did with the schools and those things. What are the rules or the constraints or the boundaries of inviting critics to those types of things, first of all? And just a quick anecdote, in the city I'm from, we have a couple of major critics who refuse to come. We send them tickets. They say, we don't do children's plays. One lady made a famous statement by saying, oh, it is about time for us to review Metro Theater. I think I'll send my 12-year-old daughter. So how do you guys think those kinds of barriers can be broken?
So let me just repeat the question for the live stream, I guess. So this question is about, you know, inviting critics or behind-the-scenes looks for more insight to kind of like draw a review. And so are there any policies and how do you guys work?
I think you can absolutely invite them and they most likely won't come. I mean, I had a conversation with Chris Jones about this and he says, I don't do that with any theater. I mean, he reviews a lot of TYA theater. He's like, I don't see that work, residencies, you know, co-show discussions at any theater.
Adult
or otherwise. And I'm like, well, fair dues, then don't be the moral compass, right, of what, right? So, I think there's gotta be a compromise on both sides. You know, I totally, nor does he or any other critic probably have the time to invest in that. So then I think they have to come from a perspective that they don't, and they are not going to invest in that. So then what does that mean in terms of how they review the play? And again, I will say the critics have been so important to the success of Steppenwolf for Young Adults programming. Without a doubt, they have really elevated the program to a national level in which the work that we do is important and done again and again, and that is valuable, and that is of course why we want to get the critics there, is to kind of raise the bar and raise the level. Always invite them. And I will say one thing, there is an amazing critic in Chicago, and her name is Ada Gray, and she is about 11 years old.
If we all read her reviews.
And I would give anything if she would review a Steppenwolf for Young Adults. I don't know, she was even at Animal Farm and she didn't review it. But she is amazing and everyone blogs about her. Everyone posts her reviews. She's been doing this since she was 6 years old. And it's because the community has said this is important, her voice is important. So make that 11-year-old voice important.
Yeah, great.
I was wondering if you guys had possibly heard like Banksy Exit Through the Gift Shop, the documentary about the London graffiti scene. And whenever somebody watches the documentary, they think, oh, that's so innovative, look at their modern art. And yet when you put it on a live stage, it becomes this huge controversy. And I just wanted to get your opinion on what makes it okay to be in a film. Though it's a true film, it's a documentary. What makes it okay to be in a film, but it's not okay to be performed on a live stage?
Well, Banksy has achieved a kind of fame. I mean, Banksy's an accepted artist right now. You know what I mean? I mean,
Banksy's mainstream.
We're not talking about Banksy. Yeah. We're talking about 20, 22-year-old young graffiti artists who, in the middle of the night, in the middle of a snowstorm, went out and wrote their names on the modern wing, the newly opened modern wing list of the artists from Chicago. You know what I mean? I think Banksy's already achieved legitimacy, so I don't think it has to do with film versus theater. I think it has to do with where the artist is in relationship to the larger community and whether or not he or she is accepted.
Although I think that film is helpful, and a lot of our teachers before they came and saw This Is Modern Art showed their students that film, which I thought was really great.
So the question was about
We're good. They can hear us.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have to tell you, I'm really conflicted about this whole discussion about the show, about enhancing people feeling it's their right to enhance private property in their own way. That's a whole very interesting conversation to have. The conversation about criticism of theater. because, you know, I wrestle with this because I find criticism to be a personal opinion, an opinion, a social commentary, I think, as well. It could be kind of viewed as. And to be upset about social commentary on social commentary is kind of odd for me. In a way, I don't know, I mean, I really kind of understand what you're talking about when you talk about, you know, the perspective that that social commentary comes from and whether or not it's appropriate to be printed in the newspaper. I just go back to Frank Rich, who is now writing, you know, editorial opinions for the New York Times, to go from writing theater reviews to social commentary. So I kind of wrestle with that idea about saying, you know, you have a responsibility, you know, to a much greater idea of what this play is and what it could say versus writing your own kind of personal commentary. I mean, once you write it, you have to, you know, live up to your own responsibilities to what you said, I suppose. But I'm just saying I'm wrestling with this discussion a lot. About how to hold someone responsible for the future of the play and, you know, things, the future of Chicago theater, and, you know, I kind of wrestle with all of this. Those were really big words that you were using there, that these people, you said, hold in their hands.
I think the reviewers aren't on the opinions page.
But they're opinions.
I know, but the reviewers aren't on the editorial page. Right there in the arts page, and I think reviewers, in other words, the public doesn't see them as, in terms of the readership, I don't think that the readership views a review the same way they view an editorial on the editorial page, which is very clearly one person's singular point of view, and there's usually a couple of them that may argue with one another, you know. But I absolutely agree with you. I think Teddy and Chris have every right to say what they want to say, and they have a very large platform on which to say it. And, we have every right as artists to produce the work we want to produce if somebody picks it up. And I think then also the community has every right to talk back, you know? I mean, you're right, it's all just opinions in the end.
Right, so like I said, yeah. I wrestle a lot with it myself. Yeah.
No, it is really, I mean, it is very interesting because it, in a way what happened is mirroring what the conversation is in the play, which is an important conversation to have.
I just want to say one more thing. At lunch today, we were talking about Montreal, and I mentioned just out of my own mouth that I was shocked when I went to Montreal for the first time because it's covered in graffiti.
Mm-hmm.
The city is covered in graffiti, and it isn't what we're used to seeing in our country at all. And, you know, I don't know if I had an opinion on that. It just was very striking to me to see the proliferation and how it was, as graffiti, as art versus gang tags or whatever, you know, which are completely different things as well.
Miami, too, there's a district of Miami that is absolutely all permission walled. It's beautiful. And then Bogota, there's, you know, I mean, it just depends on where you're going and what the city's sense of graffiti is.
And, I fair dues, it's a complicated conversation because a lot of graffiti art is bad. You know, and I, you know, and it's there's no question about it. And do you want graffiti on your you know, garage door? Do you want it on your business? No. I mean, these are all really important questions to ask. And the other important question to ask is, why is it happening? What is lacking? Why is it happening?
Can I just say something about the, you're talking about the role of criticism? I think right now arts critics, we're like dealing with this existential crisis where we're caught between newspapers, which are, you know, shrinking. They're not hiring, like, newspapers don't hire arts critics. I'm an arts reporter, I'm not an arts critic. I don't write reviews. This has been a topic within the Indianapolis community. But there's some critics at Nouveau, maybe in Indy Monthly, but the Indianapolis Star, you used to employ critics, do not employ critics anymore. I'm an arts reporter, so I kind of amplify the voices of the artists rather than my own, which I think is great, but we're kind of caught in the section of front page news, sports, and other things that drive a lot of web traffic are viewed as more essential than arts, which is like a niche category within like mainstream newspapers. And then on top of that, and the arts community that, you know, has a very interesting relationship with critics as well. And so, I think some newspapers are looking for arts communities to say, hey, can you help fund our jobs? Can you help support us writing about arts? Because I'm an arts lover, I want to write about the arts. But people over the newspaper world aren't really seeing my value. The new millennial readers, they're not paying for arts critics. And, you know, this kind of stuff happens, and you know, the relationship between the critic and the arts community gets really frayed. So I think right now, I'm just thinking, well, this, I don't know if we'll even be having this conversation in 10 years. In 10 years, it'll just be opinions unpaid on Facebook. There won't be this profession anymore. So I just think it's interesting. That's what's going through my head. You know, like, hey, Weiss, and, you know, they're older. I don't know any younger full-time. Like, if that 11-year-old can have a profession based off that, that's great. She becomes a YouTube star. That, I don't know if this is, like, this profession is very much an endangered species right now.
I think there's an issue that has me concerned about this. The outcome of this, in terms of, you know, the response and then the conversation, what I think is terrific about this is that it allows you to have a very public conversation in a variety of ways, which was exactly what you had hoped and wanted to have happen. So I think that's a huge benefit from this. I think what has me concerned about our field is when we are trying to present material that may be considered more controversial even for younger audiences, and presented in such a fear-based climate that the gatekeepers, rather than allowing this kind of public discourse, shut it down. And I'm thinking of, you know, two plays that we all know, the play Along Came Tango and the play The Transition to Pequeno, both two plays that were for much younger audiences, have had significant development in these kinds of formats. But as we know from recent events, have had a great deal of controversy about even letting them get to the point where an audience can have that kind of discussion. So, you know, and I think nothing has the volatility of issues, of particularly issues dealing with gender identity, or those hot button things that touch on what may even be such a latent and not so latent forms of homophobia, et cetera, that just flash points. So rather than just looking at this issue within this particular context for this age group, what would you have to say to those writers out here who are looking to explore controversial material or material that is so current right now in terms of producing this kind of work in a fear-based climate?
They have to do it. I mean, they have to do it. And it, you know, hopefully they can find a either an artistic partner or an artistic organization that can support that. Because there's no other way. We cannot not do it, you know, and we will fail and we will succeed. But it's those, you know, this is why we do work for young people. Because if they're not talking about it at schools, and they're not talking about it at home, and they're trying to talk about it with each other, they have to have a safe place where they can have conversations about things that are important to them and that matter. So you're gonna have to take the risk, you know? And you're gonna have to take the risk that parents may not like it, teachers may not like it, school officials may not like it, critics may not like it, but what if the students do? What if the students are changed by it? Well, then it's worth it.
I think that it's interesting because there's not a lot of theater for young adults. You know, Ali is running one of them. I don't know how many there are in the country, but that seems to be an arena that's a little bit more porous.
And that's as somebody by young adults, you don't, we're talking of specific teenagers.
Yeah, I'm talking about teenagers, high school, junior, right. Upper junior high and high school. Because there seems to be, I mean, if you look at the novels they're reading, oh my God, do you know what I mean? I mean, there seems to be a little bit more play in that group, but unfortunately there's not a lot of theaters for young adults. I think once you get into the, because my theater, Chicago Playwrights, is for elementary school kids. And that's a tougher community to, especially, it's so funny, you know, if you, those of you who are involved in TYA, in ACTEJ and have traveled, you see that we are really, we protect our kids like nobody's business in the United States of America. I mean, I think that many countries, what would be considered an adult, you know, in Moth, for example, you know, or I'm thinking of a couple of plays that I've read, but I can't imagine a theater producing because they seem so tough, you know, and I think we potentially overprotect our children. But certainly, I think where there's been controversy in Chicago, it's been around Albany Park, or this, it's been where teenagers are actually grappling with some tough territory, and that's actually where Chris has generally spoken up and said, wait a second, why are we doing this? But it's an area that seems a little bit more poor, so I'm like, how can we make more theater for young adults where if we can't do it for the elementary school kids, can we start in junior high? You know, can we start in that age when they're already thinking about gender identity, sexual violence, rebellion against the system, all of those things.
But I think I agree with you, but I think we must do it.
Oh, yeah, I agree.
Younger and younger. So, thank you for saying that.
One observation, and a couple observations. First, I think it's remarkable that theater still has this power. For forever, theaters have been a vehicle for shaking up the status quo within existing power structures. And in this day and age where I think we all feel so marginalized, because we're no longer the only game in town, that it can still do this is really, really gratifying. And it seems, so the second thing is, there's a really interesting series of rebukes stacked upon rebukes in this story. The first tagging of the outside wall with the brand new rental piano, et cetera, was a rebuke from the have-nots to the haves.
Mm-hmm.
And then the creation of this play, one could argue, was a rebuke from a have to another have. And then, right, the writing of the review, and then the response to the review,
mm-hmm.
it's an incredibly public series of comments and criticisms that's so surprising and wonderful. However, wherever you find yourself falling in the sort of socio-political spectrum represented in this story.
That's great. That's a great comment. And also that Kevin, I would say that Kevin Kowal, I mean, the rebuke on the outside of the museum, the rebuke from the civic community to the rebukers, then the Kevin writing the play as a rebuke back, you know, interviewing graffiti writers, rebuke that, and then Steppenwolf producing it. But I think
it's true. I mean, in a way, Steppenwolf is that institution
mm-hmm.
that the people in the play are talking about.
Yeah, it is.
You know, so
is the artist, is the theater world's art institute of Chicago.
Yes, mm-hmm. which is, I thought, what was so kind of cool about it. But I think that it makes me feel like we're in a comedy of manners. I rebuke you.
It's Monty.
It's like the way of the world.
Yeah.
That's cool. Awesome. Yeah.
I was very struck by, I think, a quote or a quasi-quote that one of you lobbed. You can't write this at Steppenwolf. That is so deep to me because, of course, that suggests that it could have come, what, with more veracity, with more acceptance from another theater? Who? Albany Park, Free Street, I don't know, who? And that Steppenwolf, that began as this scrappy little, completely iconoclastic, let's push against all ethics and morals, theater is now viewed as this bastion of upholding something. That has got to rake you guys over the coals, Sally. That rakes me over the coals historically. I just think that's big stuff to unpack.
Yeah, it is. And I have to say that the support that we got from ensemble members was really incredible around this.
Yeah.
Here we go. We're on the edge again. It is very interesting, isn't it? Yeah.
Just a couple of things that it's exciting that the visibility of this and the dialogue back and forth in many venues has, I think, in many ways elevated the many other theaters that are also doing work for young adults across the country who are doing great, wonderful work, but that this has been a spark point to start conversation. And so in Steppenwolf, being elevated to that kind of public discourse, I hope that other, you know, that the rest can come up as well to that level of visibility, because I think a lot of the work is invisible, though it is high quality across the United States. And then also, I would love to offer back to playwrights, being somebody who has recently been in conversation about the transition of Dudo Pequeño at People's Light, and the, I'm going to put this in air quotes, feasibility of that play. I just want to say to the playwrights in the room that please understand that in the word no, there is also a communication of respect for the work, that we don't, that in not asking you to change it, to soften it, or to water it down, that that's also part of that no. I know that that, you know, that doesn't feel good receiving that and saying, you know, no, we can't, I don't think we can do this in our community, or I don't think we can do this in our community right now. But that also means that your work maintains its integrity. And so I hope for courage in finding the right, you know, the right community. And I hope that more communities recognize that if they don't step up, or that they need to step up, because we need more of those communities that will accept that.
Yeah. Did you guys produce Transition to Hope Again?
We partnered with Gabe to take it to New Visions, New Voices, and then we produced a reading of it in a format, I don't know how many people in the room are familiar with the Theater of War, but they go into communities of veterans with Greek plays like Ajax. They do a reading of the play with professional actors. The actors lead the stage. They invite panelists who may be veterans themselves, they may be spouses, they may be medical professionals that are dealing with PTSD. They offer their personal response to the play, and then there is a facilitator who opens a dialogue amongst the panelists, the community, but that the artists step down, and they usually don't participate in the conversation. So we did the transition to the Pequeño in that model of, we presented the reading, actors left the stage, we had panelists there to respond to the work, and then we had a conversation. And it was so interesting that the conversation did not go to issues of the use of the word gay as an epithet, or to sexual identity or gender identity. It went to bullying. And the vulnerability that it exposed from the individuals in that room, some of them were our board members who are in their 70s, some of them were very young, and it ran the whole spectrum in between, but it became a discussion of bullying and not about any of those things that everybody was afraid of putting on the stage in the first place.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
1 minute.
One more question. Is there anything else you guys want to say about the conversation?
No, thank you for having us.
Thank you for having us.
So we have about 15 minutes and then take a short break.
As you know, we brought it.